I think it would be good to start a session.
Yeah, welcome everybody. Welcome to the session on the Afsluitdijk. The Afsluitdijk is one of the biggest projects presently going on in the Netherlands to make the Netherlands climate resilient. And we'll have a presentation today with involving three presenters, Frans de Kok of Rijkswaterstaat, Jelle Mens of Van Oort, and me from Bonn. Jelle and myself are also from Level, the consortium which is building Afsluitdijk, and Frans is basically the client. Next slide, please. Yeah, Henk Ovink would address this session, but he will join us later, so we can continue first with the presentation on the Afsluitdijk. Next one.
Yeah, thank you, Bas. Shall I take it over?
Yeah.
Okay, very good. Well, this is the vision if you look at the Netherlands without flood defenses. 60% of our land should be underwater. So Amsterdam and our economic centers would be drowned. Next, please. Now, as a Dutch, we have a long history with floods. For example, in 1916, we had a Southern Sea flood, 53, the North Sea flood. And in the 90s, we had serious flood risks for rivers to overflow. Take the next one, please. As a Dutch, we have a certain approach. When we have floods, we responded for the Southern Sea flood with building an Afsluitdijk. And the North Sea flood was followed with the Delta Works. And as a response to the serious flood risk in 1959, we had a program started, Room for Rivers. Next one, please. If you look at the Afsluitdijk, we started in 1927 with building. It took 5 years. And then in 32, we closed the dam. Yes, you can see it now. After that, we started to drain polders. So the Northeast Polder was created, and after that, the Flevo Polder. And in 75, we made a dam between the Flevo Polder and North Holland. In that time, we created the IJssel Lake, and that's a freshwater, a very important freshwater basin. Next one, please. Creating the dike. In that time, it was a man-made story. Many basalt blocks were laid on the dike, and the core was built of a clay boulder. Next one, please. Now, if you look to the Netherlands nowadays from space, you can see the Netherlands, and you can see the Afsluitdijk is straight. It's a very straight line, 32 kilometer long. And it's dividing the salt water sea from the freshwater ice lake. In the dike, there are two discharge sluices to drain fresh water from the ice lake to the water sea. Since 1932, the dike has protected large parts of Netherlands from flooding by sea. However, nowadays, the dike is due for regeneration. It's no longer complies with current legislated water safety standards. So we started to build at the dike. In addition, greater amounts of water must be drained. This is why the Ministry of Infrastructure and Water Management is working on reinforcement and renovation of the Afsluitdijk. So the Netherlands will also be protected against water in the future. Next. Yes. Now, what are the functions of the dike? Now, during the years, the Afsluitdijk has got extra functions. In main function, it's water safety. Because it divides the water sea from the ice lake, it's also important to drain water and to protect the freshwater basin from in the ice lake. And especially fresh water nowadays is very important. And the dike is an important connection between North Holland and Friesland, because there is a motor highway on it, and there are two slices for ships to travel from the water sea to the IJssel Lake. The renovation of the dike implies quite a lot of work. It's a dike reinforcement. The dike, 32 kilometers, must be able to withstand surge overflows. This means that it's not serious a problem when water surge across the dike during a heavy storm, because it can handle it. The project implies road improvements, construction of two storm surge barriers, construction of new pump slices, and reinforcing of existing discharge sluices, and construction of a new discharge sluice. To restore fishing routes, a special 3 kilometer long fish migration river is created, including a fish-friendly discharge sluice in the dike itself. Now, the last one is an innovative project aimed at restoring the open connection between the Asselmeer and the Waddenzee. And we expect that millions of migratory fish, such as sea trout, salmon, the river lamprey, and the eel, will use this river in the future. So doing this, we also do something for the ecosystem in return. Next one, please. Nowadays, if you look at the Asserdijk, we have an adaptive approach. We better prevent a disaster than devise measures on the aftermath. What is an adaptive delta management system? Now, the renovation of the Efteler dike will comply with current legislated water safety standards until at least 250. By implementing smart measures now, it will be possible to further reinforce the dike in the future with relatively simple interventions, because we are not done yet with the project we are building now. Also in the future, we will be adaptive. For example, the revetment on the dike seaside will last at least 100 years. But furthermore, should this be necessary in future, higher wave surge can be accommodated by further reinforcement of the lake at the IJssel site on the dike. Now, we have translated this. Next one, please. We have translated this in an inquiry to the contractors. The dike should withstand one of 10,000 year in storm. It should be resistant and overtopping. It is a classic dike profile, and now Bas can take it over. He can tell more about the dike profile and how it's built. So Bas.
Yeah, thank you, Frans. Yeah, so I work for Barmium Consult. I will start first with explaining why we need to strengthen the Afsluit dike. Basically, it's one of the primary sea defenses. The chart of the Netherlands shows in green the area above mean sea level, and in blue the area below mean sea level. So we need to protect the Netherlands from flooding, because we are mainly located below mean sea level. On the right is the graph of the prediction of the sea level rise. This weekend, or just last week, the Dutch Meteorological Office increased the prediction. So they think it will go faster in the future than they expected before. And in 100 years' time, we expect about 1 meter sea level rise. Because of sea level rise, we get higher water levels, but also these higher water levels mean that bigger waves can be generated by wind. And so the wave height at Afsluit dike in the past was about 2.5 meters significant, and it will go up to 4 meters significant. So a big increase, and therefore we need bigger armor on the seaward side of the Afsluit dike. Next one. When we started it, in 2015, there was a reference design available on the Afsluit dike. Basically, the Afsluit dike is a dam. We have water on two sides. And it has historic value. It's beautiful with nice aesthetic details. There was a design which basically preserved the look and feeling of the Afsluit dike. So it has had a rather smooth new slope. It has a smooth old slope, but also a new slope was designed with concrete cubes. But the disadvantage of concrete cubes is that you can place them closely together. And in the reference design, 220,000 of these cubes were required. And that meant that you would need a total of 450,000 cubic meters of concrete. So really big values of concrete required. In the aesthetic plan, it was also mentioned that the new reinforced Afsluit dike should still have the feeling of a dike. Breakwater armor was not allowed, and large rock armor was not allowed. Asphalt on the outside was not allowed. So it should keep the same feeling as it had over 90 years. Next one. So we as BAM, we developed in the past, we developed X-Block, a concrete breakwater arm unit, is also used in the Netherlands to defend the weak links in the Netherlands from the sea level rise and climate change. But we thought, if X-Block is not allowed on the Afsluitdijk, what should we do? Because of course we wanted to win the tender of the Afsluitdijk, and we thought, yeah, we have to come up with a new innovation which suits the Afsluitdijk. So we started modifying X-Block. X-Block is an irregular placed block, and so the orientation of each block is different, and therefore it was not allowed because that's just not fit the aesthetic requirements. We started with cutting off one leg of the X-Block, two legs, and we modified over a period of 3 years, we modified the block into a new block, which is now called level block on the Afsluitdijk, because the joint venture is level, BAM van Noord and Rebel is level. And yeah, we basically, specifically for the Afsluitdijk, developed a new block, which has a regular placement pattern, large porosity, very stable, and is suited for the Afsluitdijk. Next one. Now, to come up with this new innovation, we had to do a lot of research, and we did the research in our own laboratory, but also in other laboratories. We did research together with a lot of students, among others from the Delft University. And we can make scale models of cross-section of the Afsluitdijk and test it, and we did that, we did many tests. Apart from physical modeling, we did also numerical modeling with different computer models, so you can do computational flow dynamics. You can do a numerical modeling of the stresses, and we did it all. One of the main findings was that in the block we needed a central hole. So there is a central hole in the block, and that reduces the wave pressures at the underside of the block, and therefore increases stability. The block needs also to be robust because it's unreinforced concrete. Now finally, we came up with a very high hydraulic stability, so we can exceed the wave height by almost a factor of 2 before we get damage in an armor layer built with these blocks. Next one. Now then, of course, we came up with a solution to increase the strength of the Afsluitdijk for the coming years, to reinforce the Afsluitdijk. This graph shows you the original profile of the Afsluitdijk. You see the Afsluitdijk has a boulder clay core with sand behind it, a layer of clay on top of the sand. And we overlay this old Afsluitdijk. So we let the old Afsluitdijk, it remains in place. That means that we can continue construction in winter. And we overlay it with a structure which has a berm. So a berm is good to reduce overtopping, and we want to minimize the overtopping. And we have a rough lower slope with the level blocks or X-Block Plus. And we also have a rough upper slope with quattro blocks. And the graph below shows you the size of a level block. And it's about 1.15 meters high and about 3 meters length. They are quite big blocks. The old Afsluitdijk has basalt columns, so natural basalt columns. They weigh less than 100 kilograms, and we overlay that with blocks of 6,000 kilograms. What is also new is that we now will have a bicycle path on the outside of the Afsluitdijk. In the past, you could only cycle on the inside of the Afsluitdijk, on the inside of the dike, you would not see the sea. And now it's much nicer because when you're cycling there, you will see the water sea. Next one. Now, it was required by Rijkswaterstaat to prove that the design which the contractor provided, that you would prove it in the delta flume at Deltares. And we had to prove it at a scale of 1:3. So basically we built an Afsluitdijk, but then 3 times as small, which is really already very impressive. The delta flume is the biggest wave flume in the world. And then in this wave flume, we'll have significant wave heights of 1.5 meters, so really big. We designed for a 10,000 year return period storm. So we have very high safety standards, but still we added an extra overload case, and we also built in a weaker structure by using a lower density concrete in the model than we will use in reality. So during the lifetime of the structure, we do not expect any maintenance to these blocks. The blocks will be completely stable, while the basalt columns, which weigh less than 100 kilograms, in the past 9 years, all of them have been replaced. So there was continuous maintenance on the existing Afsluitdijk. While with the new Afsluitdijk, we do not expect maintenance to the armor layer. Therefore, there will be no CO2 footprint to, yeah, to replace or maintain these blocks. Next one. Now, CO2 footprint is, of course, very important because, yeah, because of CO2, we have climate change, and therefore, yeah, we need to adapt and we need to reinforce the offshore dike. We also want to reduce the CO2 footprint, and we, with the reinforced offshore dike, we apply 75,000 X-block plus blocks. They are 2.5 cubic meter each, and the berm blocks are slightly bigger, and they will be applied on 24 kilometers of the offshore dike. But for this armor layer, we only need 200,000 cubic meters of concrete, while for the original reference design concrete cubes, 450,000 cubic meters of concrete was required. So we save 56% on CO2 footprint by using this innovative armor layer. We also are able to produce these blocks in a fast way. So we have a dedicated factory in the port of Harlingen, which is in Friesland. And there are approximately 100 blocks that are made are cast per day, and they are transported by marine transport to the dike, so no road transport. Also, the blocks can be placed faster. Every block has the same orientation, so the crane driver exactly knows how to place the blocks. Yeah, we achieve approximately 20 blocks per hour, and the maximum length which can be placed covering part of the afsluitdijk is 500 meters of afsluitdijk in a week. Next one. Yeah, we are reinforcing the afsluitdijk, but yeah, when we are doing that, we always also want to improve the situation for sea life, for instance. What we did with these blocks is make a rough surface so that sea life can more easily attach to the blocks. We made small tidal pools so that at low tide water will remain on the blocks. And we are also going to do a new pilot where we and do special additives which also enhance marine growth on these blocks. The arm layer itself, the level block arm layer, it has about 60% porosity, so only 40% is concrete. So there are a lot of hollow spaces which can form a habitat for marine life, such as for shellfish, crabs, and lobsters. Next one. So now Jelle will continue with the next part of the presentation.
Yeah, thank you. Good morning. Thank you for the opportunity given to me to present the how, because I heard Frans talking about the why, and Bas was speaking about the what, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about the how. Of course, to lay these new blocks in the dike, you also have to produce them. And like Bas said, we produce them in a factory in Harlingen, about 15, 20 miles from the afsluitdijk in the province of Friesland. And we have an automated factory there, especially built for this project, a factory that can be taken apart and placed somewhere else in the world. So it's a kind of mobile factory. And around this factory, we created a very solid foundation for a stacking area where we can stack the blocks six high. To load the blocks into the barges for the transport, we also made our own little port. You can see in the picture that there is a kind of gap in the quay wall where we can moor our barges. There's an electric portal crane that can also load all the barges direct from the stacking area into the barge. Here you see about 10,000 blocks ready for placing in the dike. At this very moment, as we speak, we have around 12,000 blocks in stock, and we're producing around 700, 800, 840, 850 max blocks a week. And like I said, the factory is modularized, can be reused in other projects. Next slide, please. And like the other speakers, to show you how, it's much easier to do that with a good video feature. And I'm asking Quirine to start the feature. I'll explain you a bit what we see after this. And next slide, please, Matthijs. This feature was quite self-explanatory. And I'll explain you later how the gripper works and how we place the blocks. But the next feature will give you the first insight on how the placement and the real construction of the dike is done at the Afsluitdijk dike itself. So Quirine, can you start the next feature, please? So you're looking at the preparation of the dike, the overlaying, the actual overlaying with rock. Before we place the block, the roller you see is a geotextile that forms the footprint, really the toe of the slope. And the geotextile is covered with rock. So you see the three excavators working together to create the foot of the new Afsluitdijk dike. Block number one. Thank you so much. Next slide, please, Matthijs. And before I'll explain you a bit more, today is also a remarkable day. It's really a milestone that we achieved today. At the beginning of the year, we started in Braes on Dijk with laying of blocks. Braes on Dijk is approximately in the middle of the Afsluitdijk. And it's today that we reached the Vis Migration River that was earlier referred to by Bas and by Frans, which is a stretch of about 12 kilometers that has been finished actually last night. I must say 11 o'clock last night, so it was yesterday actually, but it's a big milestone for us as project team. You saw the barges that were transporting the level blocks. Each barge has about 160, 170 blocks in its hold. And the central hold that Bas referred to earlier, which is a part of the construction of the level block, is also used to lift the hull. So it's a hydraulic device. Without use of slings or wires, we can take each block quite easily and lift it to his new position. No change. The placing of the blocks is all computerized, so with GPS system in place. And before the operator releases the block, he can see on his screen if the X, Y, Z, the pitch and roll of the level block when it's placed is in order. And all the parameters have to be green when he pushes the button to release it. And only when all the parameters are in order, the block is left in its position. So if one of the parameters is red, the pitch is not correct, the Y is not correct, X, Y, Z is not correct, whatever, he removes the block again. The slope is retrimmed by another excavator, and then we try it again to get it in position. So, and each block has its own chip, so that we can also fill the database with the position X, Y, Z pitch roll of all the blocks. As you can see in the feature, the placing is done from the water side. That's quite logic. We produce them in Heilingen. They go to the site by sea, and it's something that floats that takes it from the barge and puts it in the on the slope. Next slide, please. Here you can see how it's really going to look like. It's very straight lines, like Bas said. We've done about 40,000 blocks are already in the dike, so quite a big production has already been done. You can also see the trimming of the upper slope where the ballerina, which is an excavator actually on the traverse, is placing all the quattro blocks on the upper slope. I think that was my story. Next slide, please. Yeah, I think this is.
I will continue here.
Yeah, this is your part again, Bas.
Yeah, indeed.
Thank you for listening.
Yeah. So basically, we strengthened the Afsluitdijk and with innovations. We were specifically asked by Rijkswaterstaat to come up with innovations for strengthening the Afsluitdijk against the effects of climate change. We came up with innovative shapes of blocks, but they are made of concrete. We already use aggregates made from the basalt columns, from the old basalt columns. We use that in the concrete. We use cement with low CO2 footprint, but we are also doing experiments with far better binders with a much lower CO2 footprint. Therefore, on the Afsluitdijk, in the actual slope, there's also a test section with 30 blocks, which have been produced by lot of different companies in the Netherlands. They are also named in this slide. They all have gotten the opportunity to come up with concrete with very low CO2 footprints, and they are placed in the armor layer so that we can monitor the behavior of these blocks and test the durability. because concrete has a significant CO2 footprint, and also we want to reduce that CO2 footprint. Therefore, we are happy that Afsluitdijk is also approved in a trial area where further innovations can be tested. Next slide. So in the slope of the Afsluitdijk, there is already new innovations going on. We also want to do together with Rijkswaterstaat a new trial area, new proof tuin at the Afsluitdijk, and therefore we also want to test further innovations. We are looking at further modifications to the shape of the block to enhance it for a habitat for marine life. We want to do additives in the concrete to make it easier for marine life to attach. We are also trying further innovations. So level block / X block plus is an innovation that's now also applied in other parts of the world. And we want to, at Afsluitdijk, we have long straight stretches with mild curves. We want to make stronger curves. We also want to try that. Another innovation is mentioned here, Extreme. Coming Friday, I will have a presentation on Extreme blocks, which are basically small X blocks which are used as pilot in the IJssel River as river groins. So we keep on innovating in the Netherlands. We want to innovate. We have the effects of climate change. We need to adapt. Therefore, we need to continue innovating to be able to handle the effects of climate change. Next slide. So this finalizes our presentation, and it's time for questions, and we will hopefully be able to answer your questions. There is one question in the, you can put your questions in the chat. I see one question in the chat on to implement, where the possibilities to implement more nature-based measures, perhaps in front of the dikes itself. One of the dike is next to the Waddenzee, and the Waddenzee is a nature reserve. So we were not allowed to go into the nature reserve. So there was quite a strict line in front of the existing toe of the Afsluitdijk in which the strengthening of the Afsluitdijk should take place. So we were limited in there. No beaches could be built, no artificial reefs could be built. So we were limited in strengthening the Afsluitdijk within this footprint. Therefore, we have chosen the solution as it is and try to maximize the possibilities for nature within the solution. Are there other questions?
I believe no questions anymore, Bas.
I think we've been very clear then, Bas.
Yes.
Yep.
You had a good story. I think we can close or not, because I see.
No.
Oh wait.
Questions coming in.
Good. Okay.
Yes. Do you see the Q&A, Bas, as well?
Yeah, I see the Q&A. Yeah. Yeah. So basically we are strengthening the Afsluitdijk, and we have two aspects. So we have stability of the seaward side of the strengthening. And we have overtopping, so we are allowed a maximum overtopping of 10 liter per linear meter per second of the Afsluitdijk, and we also had a maximum crest level of the crest of the reinforced Afsluitdijk at plus 10, and that's basically focused on 2050, so the coming 30 years, and that's because there's still a lot of uncertainty on the climate change on the sea level rise, and therefore after 30 years it's very easy to raise the crest, which is basically grass on clay. We can still raise it for the stability of the armor, which you will not replace easily. We look at 2100. And at 2100, we are close to 1 meter sea level rise, and so in that order of magnitude. But of course, in 30 years' time, the sea level rise will not be that much. And we designed basically for the KNMI B plus scenario. Other questions?
No, I think, Bas, then you are now very clear, or not?
Yeah, so if there are no more questions, we'll finalize this session.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a pity that Henk was absent, but I think we have to thank everybody for enjoying this session.
I think Tabea is putting a question in the Q&A section. So on which climate scenarios? Yes, if you can see it, or do I need to read it for you, Bas?
No, that's the one which I just answered.
Yes.
So okay. Plus scenario, and in 100 years time, we have about 1 meter sea level rise. So
there's a second question on it from Tabea.
I have only one question from Tabea in my Q&A.
Yes, it's what about nature-based solutions, how they are considered?
Yeah, so but the first question from Mace de Wit was on nature-based solutions, and that's so because the footprint in which we are allowed to strengthen the Afsluitdijk is limited because of Natura 2000. So Waddenzee is Natura 2000 area, so nature reserve. So we are not allowed to go into this nature reserve. So we cannot apply any nourishments or any. We can't do anything in this Natura 2000 area. So therefore, we had to strengthen the Afsluitdijk within the footprint of it.
Yeah, does that question is also answered?
Yeah, so the whole process of building the or overlaying the dike doesn't touch the nature or the environment,
exactly,
in the vicinity of the dike at all. And in essence, you could say that is the best nature-based solution that you could find. So
And apart from that, of course, we make a fish migration river. So we make a new connection between the Waddenzee and the IJsselmeer, because especially it's very difficult for the fish to pass the sluices, pass the discharge sluices. So there will be a fish migration river, which makes it much easier for the fish to travel from sea to upstream to the rivers. But that's being done. And also, the growth on the existing basalt slope, all the seeds are taken from the plants living there, and they are replanted on the new slope. So there are measures taken. And of course, in the level block layer, we make it easy for sea life to find a new habitat within this layer.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Bas. And thank you, Bas, for co-presenting with me. And I don't see any questions, so
we can finish.
We're through.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you all.
Thank you all.
Thank you all for listening to us.
Thank you, Bas, Jelle, and Frans, and the others. And see you next time.
Okay. Thank goodbye.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.